going to take you back just a little bit. Whole 8 days ago. Many of you were here for the sermon that Brooks and I did, talking about what we need to give our children and what we need to be as a church for one another. You remember this? I would argue that this is just a continuation of the same. You see, as I was working this week, I was having a hard time. The Good Shepherd story for me has been told so many times. From the time I could hear a story, I heard it. Right? You go into Sunday school at the age of 3 and they say, here's a picture of a lamb, color it. Now put cotton balls on it, have a good day. And then it grows from there. And we tell you, this is partly because I have a voice, right? Tell them the guts and glory stories. You know, Pharaoh chasing them through the Red Sea and what happens to the Egyptians. Tell them the stories of David and Goliath, but tell them the other stories too, where David did things wrong. Obviously, at the age that they can hear them, but so that they know that we don't have to be perfect and still turn to God. So one of the things about Scripture is that it gives us a group of people that is glorified for their imperfection. What it does is it gives us a group of people who fail at every turn, who doubt at every turn, and yet God still reaches out for them. Does this sound familiar to anybody? Because if you have children, I'm sure you're really good at this. Or grandchildren. Or if you turn on a computer and look on the internet at any point in time, you're really good at doubting what you're doing. Can I tell you this as loud as it doesn't matter? You're going to mess it up. Big time. And God's still going to love you, and God's still going to search for you, and God is still going to be willing to lay down his life for you. And that's the same refrain we need to be telling our children. You're going to do this whole life thing wrong at some point. You're going to do it really well at some points, but you're also going to screw up royally, and I'm still going to love you. I'm still going to be here. And even when I discipline you, I'm loving you. That's the refrain they need to hear from us over and over and over again. This morning at Meal, I had the pleasure of being part of a baptism. See, this is the really cool job I get to do. I get to hold babies. Like, I just get to do it. It's fun. In the middle of the sermon, she starts to cry, so I pick her up. It's really nice that you all trust me to not drop them. Thank you. I pick her up, and I'm rocking back and forth and talking to her, and I didn't have to say another single word the rest of the sermon because she was taking care of it for me. But this baby, her father grew up in this church. Her father wanted to make sure that she was baptized in the church that shepherded him. See, when Jesus talks about being the good shepherd, he's saying, this is what I've done for you, now do likewise. This is where it comes full circle. So when we stand up and we make promises, we're parents and godparents of a child, they're pretty clear and pretty profound promises. But then the entire congregation is called upon to make the same promises back. To tell that family that they will be there to support them, to love them, to help them along the way. And if we lose any one of our kids or our families because we're not doing this, shame on us. Here's what happens. Life gets really hard. They're really cute when they can't walk. Right? Okay, maybe before they can crawl. But then you start looking at things. You start laying on the floor to see what might be exciting for them to pull on. And as they get bigger, you think that you still have to look at everything at their height. You think that your job is to protect them from everything in the world, and it's not. Your job as parents, but also our job as a church, is to give them the tools to fight off wolves when they show up. And tell them the stories of their Savior's voice over and over again, so that when their God calls them, they know who to follow. So they don't go over the cliff with everyone else. That's what we're called to do. This is what it looks like. It looks like when someone leaves our parish after Senior Sunday and heads off to college, they know that this entire room loves them. They know that this entire room is available to them when things get hard. They don't wonder when they get a random card from somebody at Econ if they had a stalker or not, because they already know your names. Right? And they know that they are wonderfully made and therefore deeply loved. Their family doesn't exist just within the four walls they grew up in. But it's here. See, you're the ones that I know will stop my child from running into the parking lot at Village Market because I can't get to them fast enough. You're the ones that I know when I can't pick somebody up because the rest of my job gets in the way and Chris's schedule is the same, I can call you and I know that we'll be safe. You're the ones who are going to engage in a wrestling match in the back of the church and still correct them when they're putting someone else in danger by running laps. And do it in a way that they know that this is home and they have no other place where they belong except here. This is what it means to shepherd. It means that when we see a family, that something is just not right, we may not know all the details, we show up and we're just present. It means that anyone in this building or in this church can call anyone else in a time of need. They don't have to call Burks or I. Because they know that everyone in this parish is Christ for them. These are the kinds of promises we make in baptism. The promises to teach one another, to uplift one another, and to protect one another when things get bad. Children who are raised in religious families, on the whole, do better academically, have better skills at facing life, and have the tools to go forth and be successful wherever you're choosing to be. That's huge. That's seen across every faith. Consistent involvement in a worshiping body gives kids safety net that they need to go out and risk everything. To even go off when they hear that call to places where wolves might be. Places where it might be scary, and yet they know they have a safe place to land. Invite, this is the men's Bible study, at a very, really, really early time on Thursday morning. This week, I had the pleasure of sitting with these gentlemen and going through the lectionary and talking with them about everything. And one person asked, why is it that we don't see miracles like they saw in the early church? Why aren't people healed in the city walls? My response was, because we're not looking. I would argue that God works actively through all of us to perform miracles all the time. We just have used science to explain it away. It is a miracle that a doctor can put his hands or her hands on someone's heart and fix it. Maybe not perfectly, but some way. It is a miracle that we have the knowledge now to know how to keep our teeth. And when we can't, we have those people who have been trained and skilled enough to help us along the way. It is a miracle that we have teachers who are willing to stand up in classrooms every single day and tell kids that they love them and that they're more important than subtraction signs. That they start first with their relationship with their students and then teach them things. And it is an even greater miracle that we have people who will sit with people when they are broken and just hold their hand. When they are dying, and just be present with them and with their families. You see, God performs miracles every single day. We've just forgotten how to look for them. And God is using you, again, by calling you to follow Jesus' example. That in acting as a shepherd for those closest to us, we will help our kids and one another survive with great dignity, to go out into the world and show the light to everyone else, so bright that they go, what do they have that I don't? This is how the church exploded exponentially, because people looked at the martyrs that were being put in front of lions and said, what do they have that I don't? The people who were willing to lay down their lives for the others that they were called to love. So I want to say thank you. Thank you for teaching my children what it is to be a community that follows Christ. Thank you for giving them a place that